Can I ask everyone to please stand? If you guys would just bow your heads for me. Gracious and Heavenly Father, God, we come to you right now just to say thank you, God. Thank you for allowing us to see another school year, God. And we actually got to come down and send the success upon this great university, God. And we pray all these things in your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Will. Yeah, please be seated. I think everybody got that already. So great to see everybody here. Welcome to the University of Pikeville's opening convocation. This is a wonderful tradition that we've had at the institution for many years now, where we bring together all of the first-year students from, in this case, all of the many colleges that we have, and we have so many students who are here for the very first time. We have optometry and medical students in addition to the first-year undergraduate students, and we're very happy to announce that the first-year undergraduate student class this year is over 400 students. So we're very, very happy with that. It's also excellent to see all of the faculty here, and I think there are a few trustees in the audience. I see Trustee Emeritus Bill Baird is here. I'm looking around the room, and some of you may be hiding, so if I don't call your name, please excuse me. I think Governor Patton and Judy are here somewhere, but I don't see, oh, there they are right there. Good to see them. Welcome, Governor. Good to see them as well. And then my wife is here, too, sitting in the midst of the faculty over here because she's teaching a little bit this year, which is great. So it's good to have everybody here, and welcome. We have today a wonderful opportunity for you to listen to someone speak who is a native to this great Commonwealth. Jared Arnett is an alumnus of this institution, but in November of 2014, he began a new journey as the founding executive director for an organization called Shaping Our Appalachian Region, or SOAR. SOAR is a really interesting organization, and if you were around last week, you probably noticed that there were no parking spots in the garage, and we had people wandering everywhere through town, about 1,300 of them. I'm told it was the largest SOAR event since their first event. But their identity is to help the region of Appalachia, all throughout the ARC's counties of Appalachia, to begin to think about how we might cooperate to develop economically, how we might become more proactive as entrepreneurs, how we might continue to grow and to shape this great region. Prior to serving in that role, Jared was the president and CEO of the Southeast Kentucky Chamber of Commerce, where he was instrumental in bringing in new businesses to this region and thinking strategically about what we might do next. He's been a small business owner in this area for many years, started his own consulting firm, sold musical instruments, and also pastors one of our local churches. So please join with me in welcoming this morning's speaker, Mr. Jared Arnett.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is great to be here this morning. I got a question to start with, and this is to the freshmen. Maybe it's to all of us. Where will you be 18 years from now? Where will you be 18 years from now? And you say, why are you picking 18 years? Because for me, 18 years ago, I was sitting in your seat, half time, half a lifetime ago for me. I'm 36. Who's the math majors in here? Y'all just start. You got three math majors. Only ones that are confident enough to claim it. Half a lifetime ago for me, I sat where you're sitting. It's hard for me to understand or even explain where time goes, where the years go. All I really know is that it's day by day. And those days are made up of moments that require decisions. And when Dr. Webb asked me to speak today, I began to think about the critical moment and time that you all are in and how important the decisions you're going to make over the next 4 years are to the rest of your life. And I made some bad ones, and I made some good ones. But this morning, I just want to share a few of those moments that impacted me, because much like you, I had no idea where I was going to be 18 years from now when I sat in your seat. I had no idea someday I'd own my own business. I had no idea someday I'd be the CEO of anything ever. I had no idea that I'd ever work for a governor. I had no idea that I'd ever pastor a church. None of that was even, I did not come here saying, that's what I'm going to do. I had no idea. You see, I was raised about 45 minutes from here in the head of a holler. Some of y'all know what a holler is, right? Near Salyersville. And my first trip to campus, I was ready to move in. I packed my truck up. I was ready to get here. And I came in and I checked in my dorm room. I walked up, looked at the dorm room in Wickham Hall. And I took the keys back downstairs. That's no joke. Real story. And I drove back home with my truck full of stuff. And I got there, and my dad was like, why are you here, and why is the stuff still in your truck? And I realized I'd made a decision out of fear of failure, scared of new things. And he said, just go back. They had this thing called convocation where every freshman was required to come to. And I came back to convocation, and I met my roommate, and I had my stuff in my truck just in case, and I moved in. I learned from that moment, that experience, that not to make decisions out of fear of failure, and that if you're comfortable, you're not growing. I was very uncomfortable. I was totally outside of my comfort zone. And if that's where you are today, let me share that you're in a good spot. Because that's what life is. From here on out, you will be growing, and there will be times where you will be uncomfortable. That moment helped me when one of my buddies called me and said, hey, we should start our own guitar store. What do you think? And I thought, huh? I'm not going to be afraid of failure. So with a keyboard and prayer as my investment, we started a guitar store called Mountain Music Exchange. For that moment came back to my mind when I was working at the Chamber of Commerce and my boss, the CEO, got another job and he resigned and he looked at the board of directors and he said, you need to hire Jared. Don't do a search. Just hire Jared. He's the right guy for the job. And I was 27. And I remember my wife and I talking and thinking, what is happening here? And I remember on the special call meeting with the board of directors, there was the chairman said, Jared, interesting. So he said, Jared has earned his right to fail. Didn't know if that was a vote of confidence or a reminder that, yeah, I could fail, and it wouldn't be the end of the world. I'll say this, too, when I walked on this campus, I didn't know that I'd marry the girl who sat down beside me in my first class, but I did. I can't make any promises that's going to happen to y'all. Now y'all going to your first class saying, who was it that I'm going to marry? I can't promise, but it happened for me here on this hill. And when Jim Host called me, and they'd started this thing, the governor and Congress started this thing called SOAR, and he called me, and they were doing this national search for founding executive director, and I was telling people all around me, saying, whoever takes that job is crazy. And Jim Host called me, and he said, why haven't you sent me your resume? I said, because whoever takes that job is crazy. And he said, send me your resume. And I sent him my resume. And then I found myself in the top three being selected for this movement that was supposed to shape and recreate and reimagine the future in Appalachia, Kentucky. What I saw is a tremendous challenge and crazy, ridiculous risk turned into my wife and I sitting outside in the car before I went into that interview saying, this could be the opportunity of a lifetime. Not for me, but for this work. And I thought, I can't make this decision out of fear of failure, because guess what? I failed. And I'm still here. It's not fatal. Failure is not fatal. I've failed many times, many projects. Projects I've been a part of, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Big time vision, putting big things on the line, and it goes nowhere. You will determine your future on what you do when you fail. I've also found this out, that success is not final, because I've been part of big projects that were big successes. And in life, you're only as good as what you've done this week or today or what you're going to do tomorrow. Life is about keeping on, keeping on. When I was getting ready to take the job at Sora, there was a guy that was an interim director. His name was Chuck. And I said, Chuck, man, they called all these leaders back together and the governor and congressman, and he was supposed to present everything he had heard and what the plan was for the future. And we'd lost, 12,000 coal mining jobs. It felt like everything was on the line. And I was stressed out. I was just presenting like a 5-minute little report. And I said, Chuck, aren't you stressed to put this meeting together? And he said something to me in that moment that just sat with me, and it was about perspective this entire time. He said, real stress is not knowing how to feed your family. And in that moment, I was like, okay, I'm pretty blessed in this moment. And I've used that from that point forward in the work that we do. I'll share this. There's some people that made an impact in my life. Those are all moments that made an impact. There's people. Everett Wendland, when I was a senior in high school, he taught band at McGaughey County High School for 1 year. I was a musician, thought I was going to do music all my life. And he saw some talent in me and said, hey, Jared, you know what you should do? I got a buddy that teaches at UPike, Pikeville College then. And he's got a community education class. And I was a senior in high school. You should go to Pikeville and be a part of that class. I thought, okay, I never thought about doing anything like that, but okay. So me and one of my buddies from McGaughey County, we started driving up here once a week. That, my friend, is when I found out Pikeville was not JCPenney and Coal Run. When I was a kid, my whole life, when we went to Pikeville, we went to JCPenney and Coal Run. And I found out that Pikeville had a downtown. But I started building relationships with this place and this university and the people, and music is what brought me here. Then I had an adjunct professor here, Jay Flippin, a piano instructor. He said, Jared, you could play music. And he spoke hope into me. Then I had my girlfriend at the time, her mom, because I was having trouble getting life together. She looked at me and she said, I think you'd be good at business. Well, I don't know how many words that is. Where's our math majors, 4 or 5? I think you'd be good at business. And I went, people have already always told me I could be anything I ever want. And that's pretty overwhelming, honestly. But to have somebody say, I think you got this skill set, this trait, you could be good at this. I said, okay. I started taking business classes. She knew I was going to be her future son-in-law. When I got here, one thing I didn't understand was the value of the opportunity I'd been given. I didn't understand what my professors were going to share with me had tremendous value. I didn't understand that it wasn't about just a piece of paper, but it was about the knowledge. It was about the challenge I was going to overcome. It was about learning how to get things done and accomplish things, and a push to dig deeper. I didn't understand that there were some people that would never have the opportunity to sit where you're sitting today, to sit where I was sitting that day. They couldn't afford to. They had life challenges that just prevented it from happening. I didn't understand so much that my first semester I dropped out. 6 months later, I was broke, dead end road, had no idea where I was headed. I was thankful at that point. I realized the value, and the president of the university at the time had enough compassion when I reached out on a hope and a prayer and said, could I get my scholarship back for a second year? I wrote a letter, and they saw fit to give me a second chance. There may be a lesson there of grace and second chances. There may be a lesson, don't drop out of school, because I found out real quick that wasn't the answer. But there's also the lesson that no matter where you've come from, what decisions you've made, what bad things have happened in your life, there's still hope. And there's still good things that can come of it. After college, I didn't start out as a CEO. My first full-time job was as a bookkeeper in a broke small business. My job was to pay the bills. I went in and there was no money to pay the bills. The bills were stacked up. I was making $8.50 an hour, no benefits. Does that sound like the promise you've been given with college? Now, not every degree leads to that, but what I had was an understanding from education, and I had knowledge, and I had an opportunity to show I knew how to use it. And I began from that point to work and give my all to help those around me and make a difference. I realized at that point that relationships were the most important thing, and people talk about networking, how it leads to success, and I realized that networking is not about what you can get from other people, but what you can give. If you take life from the approach that you want to help people, I promise you'll succeed. You know, my story is just one of many. Thousands of people have come through these doors, and I'm not the most successful. But I believe that God gives us purpose, and once you find it, you pursue it with all you've got. I believe the old proverb said, in our heart we'll devise a plan, but he will direct our steps. There's some unique partnership between our Creator that makes success beautiful. Success for me is not entitled, salaries, homes, any of those things that we might chalk it up to be. For me, it's about making a difference in our guitar store. What I love about it is I remember being the kid walking in the guitar store in Paintsville, Kentucky, and looking at the guitars and dreaming about what it would be like to be able to play one. And to see those kids that walk in, they learn how to play, they start writing their own songs, eventually they're in a band, and we get to be a part of that journey. At SOAR, it's about seeing communities that at one point didn't believe they could do it, but now believe they can and have hope and resources to pursue their dreams. To see thousands of jobs created, to see families who were in addiction and now in recovery and working and seeing what that means for them. And SOAR, or as a pastor, seeing people find hope in hopeless situations and care more about their neighbors than themselves, for me that's success. When we were in college, I'm finishing with one story, we had this amazing car. It was a Ford Focus. And it was the first year they ever made it. Ford, their first Ford Focus. We called it the Egg. It was white, had two doors and a hatchback. It was four-cylinder, got great gas mileage when it ran. And it would, we'd start up. It was one of these cars that you'd start up a hill and literally start bogging down. I mean, literally, like just a normal hill. I'm not talking about on a strip job. I'm talking about like on the parkway. It starts dying going up a hill. And I did this thing that was new at the time called Googling it. And so I Googled, what is up with this car? Why is it dying all the time? And so there was this blog online that showed you how to fix it. I am not a mechanic. I am some things a mechanic. I am not. It said pop the hood. It was step by step. I thought, I can do step by step. It said pop the hood. It had a picture. It pointed an arrow. It said, see that hose? Pull it off. I pulled that hose off. It said, now get a golf tee. I said, okay. So I got a golf tee, and it said, put that golf tee in the hose. I put it in the hose. I don't know what hose it was. But mine had a golf tee in it. So I put the golf tee in. I started up. I mean, it fixed the problem. It ran beautiful. The air conditioner tore up. We took it to the mechanic. He was working on it. He called me. He said, man, do you know you've got a golf tee and your some EGR valve or something. I don't even know what he called it. You know you got a golf. I said, don't touch it. What I realized through that is that success and team efforts depend on every piece part of the whole. That it doesn't matter how big or small or what title we have, we play a role in bringing things to fruition. The engine could not work without the golf tee. And I realized that no matter what part of the hole I was going to play, I just wanted to be a part of making a difference. You can do that today. The summit last week, great success, over 1,300 people. I get to stand on the stage and speak. There are hundreds, thousands of people behind the scenes, some of them here today. We got these video guys back here from Pike TV that helped make the thing successful, that believe in it, that are part of it. I mean, they did an incredible job running production. Teddy's here somewhere running sound. You got people in the kitchen. You got people everywhere making things work, and it's never about me. It's about the sum of the whole. So I'll finish with this. Where you will be 18 years from now, I have no idea. But it will be your attitude that says things aren't going to happen to me. I'm going to happen to things that makes the difference. They used to ask me when I was at the chamber, where's Eastern Kentucky going to be? What's the future of Eastern Kentucky? And I heard this person, this lady, an executive from Xerox once say, the best way to predict the future is to create it. And that's what I used to say. We're not going to wait and see. We're going to create it. It speaks to the opportunity that's before you today at the University of Pikeville. You can be wherever you want to be 18 years from now. And I'll tell you a secret. I don't feel much different now than you do where you are. Honestly, I'd rather be sitting with you, signing up for classes, picking out a major. That sounds really fun. That sounds like a world of opportunity. I also, all of us up here, we don't know where we're going to be 18 years from now. And we're facing the same things you're facing. Where you are 18 years from now is up to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Jared. One thing strikes me, I think your mother-in-law was only partly right. You are pretty good at business, but I think that what you're really good at is hope. Thanks, Jared. I deeply appreciate those words. Thank you so much. Last year, during opening convocation, the university instituted an award for those who have left an indelible legacy of service to humanity. The award is named for a family who has given so much to the University of Pikeville and to the community of Pikeville over the years. It's a community we love and their people we love. Many of this family's actions are known only to those people who are blessed by them. But last year, we started the inaugural Baird Family Service Award, and it was conferred for the first time on Trustee Emeritus Bill Baird. Bill, would you stand for just a minute so folks can see who you are? At the same time, we awarded Trustee Greg Pauly and his wife Kathy the Baird Family Service Award for devoting their lives to selflessly serving the children and families who are in need in the Louisville area. And I don't know if the Paulys are here today. Are they here? I wasn't sure if they could make it. They're probably busy with the kids that they serve. We did that at that time. There are really no criteria for the award. There's nothing that says that we have to give it every year. It's reserved really for people who embody the same spirit of service that's exemplified by the Baird family and has been for a long time. So in some ways, it's a bit of a rare occurrence that we run across folks like that, but we do take nominations for this award anytime during the year, and one of those folks has come to the forefront. This year, a name arose that we couldn't overlook because she's made the life of countless folks from Eastern Kentucky so much better. Her name is Eula Hall. The road to a healthy population here in Appalachia is much like the roads that we see here. They're steep and curvy and narrow and difficult to navigate. However, Eula Hall has created a roadmap by meeting the health and social needs and removing barriers to healthcare for so many people in our community. Eula has been called an angel. She's been called dynamite, a force to be reckoned with, and a living legend. Over 70 years ago, she saw the need for better health care in eastern Kentucky and has devoted her life to that cause. She was born into a family of limited means right here in Pike County, and having achieved an eighth grade education, Ms. Hall realized early in life that people were treated differently based on their economic status. She saw the effects of not having available health care. She has seen babies die from dysentery, young lives lost to tuberculosis right in these mountains, and her own mother almost bled to death during childbirth. Through the years, she has helped others by caring for the elderly, delivering medication and food, driving people to the nearest hospital, sometimes over 30 miles away. In the Mud Creek area of Floyd County, she is known as someone people can turn to when they are sick, hungry, or cold. When the war on poverty began in 1964, many of its supporters came to eastern Kentucky, but none of them stayed. None of them stayed as long as Ms. Hall. In the early 1970s, she spent much of her time pitching her idea of a local healthcare clinic to politicians, healthcare providers, donors, and anyone who would listen. She dreamed of bringing quality healthcare to the people who were so difficult to get to. In 1973, with a donation of just $1,400 and the commitment of two local physicians, Ms. Hall opened the Mud Creek Clinic in Grethel, Kentucky. The clinic served all those who needed it, regardless of their ability to pay. The clinic grew, and in 1977, Ms. Hall joined forces with the Big Sandy Healthcare System, a move that made the Mud Creek Clinic eligible to receive federal funding and begin to expand patient care. After the merger, Ms. Hall continued as a patient advocate at the Mud Creek Clinic, a position she continues to hold today, 70 years later. In 1982, Ms. Hall and the Grethel community suffered a devastating loss when the Mud Creek Clinic burned. But with her usual tenacity and perseverance, she matched the $80,000 request from the Appalachian Regional Commission and raised an additional $40,000 to not only rebuild the clinic, but to outfit it with a state-of-the-art x-ray machine. Ms. Hall also helped to create the Mud Creek Water District, which provides safe water for a community where over 90% of residents used water from contaminated wells. Through the years, she has helped people with black lung compensation claims, disability claims, Social Security, and has connected countless numbers of people to food and housing and medication. Ms. Hall has received numerous honors and awards for her work, including honorary doctoral degrees from the University of Pikeville, as well as Berea College, Midway College, Trinity College in Hartford, Connecticut. In 2004, Appalachian Ministries Education Resource Center presented Ms. Hall with their annual David S. Schuller Spirit of America Award. In 2006, the Kentucky General Assembly passed a resolution naming Kentucky Highway 979, the road that runs right through Mud Creek, the Eula Hall Highway, in her honor. In October of 2010, Ms. Hall was inducted into the University of Kentucky College Public Health Hall of Fame. She has received personal letters from many people, including President George Bush, Senator Edward Kennedy, Senator Mitch McConnell, and Congressman Hal Rogers, recognizing her dedication to the health and well-being of her region. Eula Hall understands more about the importance of eliminating poverty than most of the experts know. She knows that overcoming poverty is more than giving people sufficient material goods. It means giving the poor a voice in making decisions that directly affect them. It means a healthy body. It means a healthy mind. It means giving them what they need to escape poverty by finding meaningful employment. It means having clean water, a warm coat, and a voice. Eula Hall has spent her life offering that voice to the people of eastern Kentucky. Please join me in congratulating the newest recipient of UPike's Baird Family Service Award, Ms. Eula Hall.
I want to thank you all for this honor. I've worked hard. I've done my best. I still do. I worry about the people that I'm afraid won't get the service they need when they need it. I still got my car on the road transporting the patients into the clinic and out of the clinic. I have a food pantry. I feed the people that may be short of food. You know, and I help the people with their medication. I'm still there as a patient advocate every day. And I'm there because I worry about these people, and I'm afraid they won't get everything they need when they need it if there's not, you know, somebody there and that can do it for them. So I thank you all so much for this honor. You know, I didn't do what I've done in my lifetime. I never done it to be recognized for it. I done it for the people to have service they needed that they didn't have and couldn't afford. So I just thank God I'm still here and able to help the people when they need me. That's what I, it's the way I want to continue my life. I want to again thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. I think you can see that service is a big component, not only of what we do as an institution, but who we are as a community. And it's lives like Jared's and like Eula's that stand as an example for all of us and call us to even greater service. So thank you, Eula. We thought we'd do something a little bit different. In the past, we've often had this moment in time where we have someone come and sing a song. And you know, it's nice, it's entertaining, and it's something that is enjoyable. But this time, we heard a rumor that there is someone who has a slightly different talent, and we've asked him to engage in his talent to write something original for us. And so, Ben, Dr. Koenig, would you come and deliver your address?
All right, guys. I wanted to just let you guys know I've actually evolved. I'm not Dr. Koenig anymore. I'm Postdoc Koenig. So, and you guys will see why in just a minute. So, all right, I'm ready for you.
If I called, got you on campus, all, and now you're here and ready to go on to the farm. Work till years done, we said you can do anything. We wanna say it's convocation. Work so hard all day for your vocation. Yeah, we know you got the dedication. Study hard and go to class and look, you'll make it. Yeah, you'll make it. Everyone here's friendly, yeah. And the whole UPAC family, yeah. Got a lot of bear ballers, yeah. Straight up repping them hollers, yeah. Got the faculty and staff, yeah. Here to help you on your path, yeah. Whether it's basic math, yeah. Or the medical craft, yeah. Everyone wanna change the world and be important.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Call your advisor and make an appointment.
Yeah.
Freshman, first time you're away from your home.
Yeah.
You don't gotta feel like you're alone.
Yeah.
If you want some knowledge, put your textbooks to the sky. Try to make some sense of all the learning on your mind. Cutting out distractions, come on up to 99. All you seniors about to throw your caps up high. Yeah, you pie call, got you on campus, all, and now you're here and ready to go on to the fall. Work till the year is done, we said you can do anything. We wanna say it's convocation.
It's convocation.
Work so hard all day for your vocation. We all know you got the dedication. Study hard and go to class and look, you'll make it. Yeah, you'll make it. You'll be patient, yeah. Oh, you'll be patient.
Hey, oh.
Hit them books and scream you made it.
Made it.
And everyone, everywhere you go, yeah, they say congratulations.
Ooh.
Everybody, graduation.
Yeah.
You pick up the rock and go ball, baby.
Ball.
Then grab a champion for all, baby.
Whoa.
But now, perfect game situation.
Hey.
Rolling strikes over the nation. Big brains.
Yeah.
Champion. Esports. Hearthstone. Archery. Got the bow and arrow. Perfect bullseye. Ain't no zero.
Zero.
Swimming hall, page hall, getting Kinza hall.
Skirt.
White coat lifestyle, O-D-N-D-O. Yo, grab your MBA or Miss Doe. You know what you own. Now Dr. Kinnick is gone.
Of the faculty who we hire at University of Pikeville. One more round of applause. Could I please have our new undergraduate faculty chair, Dr. Ella Smith-Justice, join me at the mic, and then our Student Government Association presidents. And I also want the audience, would you please rise? Partway through our program, you will see our litany of scholarships. So yes, please stand. Partway through the program, you will see our litany of scholarship. The University of Pikeville is a Christian college that strives to represent the broadest sense and best sense of Christian hospitality. The litany has a strong tradition within the Christian faith. It is part confession, part prayer, and part affirmation of our commitments to each other. This morning, we enter the tradition of the litany as we join together to read these words. While many in our community are comfortable proclaiming the words that follow as their own, there are some people in the UF Pike family who hold beliefs that are different. We recognize and welcome everyone here, whether you agree with these words or not. Each paragraph begins with a word in bold. We invite you to read aloud with your representative or listen. All who are comfortable are welcome to read aloud the sections headed with the UPike family. When Jesus was asked, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" He said this, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself."
Like the lawyer who asks Jesus the question, we are quieted by his answer. We who believe, long to love God and keep God's commandments, are moved to confess and to consider what this means for us. We who long to love our neighbor are likewise challenged.
We who believe confess that we have not always kept the greatest commandments. We have not always loved God with all that we are, and have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
When we come anywhere close to loving God, it is only through God's immeasurable grace. But we who believe long to love God wholly and unfailing with all that we are. And we believe that this command is embodied in the love that we demonstrate to those around us, especially those with whom we disagree. That's why we are here at this time and in this place.
We who believe want to know what it means to love God with our hearts, our souls, and our minds. We want to show that love to everyone with whom we interact.
Is it an ironic that as members of an academic community, we seem to think the least and know the least about loving God with our minds? We've too often been deceived by the notion that love has nothing to do with the intellect, nothing to do with the thinking or imagining, nothing to do with the wrestling to understand. We forget that love rejoices in the truth.
But we want to remember, we want to discover truth.
And we forget all the places the truth can be discovered, in scriptures, of course, but also in libraries, in laboratories, on athletic field, in the gymnasium, in scripts and scores, in the laws of sines and angles, with microscopes or stethoscopes, beside a kiln or a clarinet, embedded in lecture or a leaf or a link, woven into financial statement or a speech or a sonnet, bound into a book on Newton's second law, on educational psychology, or World War II.
We want to remember. We need to remind one another. We want to discover the truth and dedicate ourselves to understanding.
Such a desire is meaningless without commitment and hard work. It involves taking care of our bodies and souls. It involves exercising our minds.
It requires reading, listening, observing, collaborating, memorizing, questioning, articulating, thinking, and writing.
It requires sketching and plotting, imagining, theorizing, explicating, analyzing, resting the body and mind when needed rest.
It requires explaining and re-explaining, figuring and refiguring, demonstrating and illustrating, practicing and practicing some more.
Help us, Lord, to commit ourselves to the pursuit of truth, to loving you with our minds.
To devote our time, gifts, and energies to gaining the deepening and sharing of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding.
To pursue an education and not just credits, knowledge and not just diplomas, wisdom and not just degrees.
To maintain humility, always acknowledging the infinite mysteries of faith and dimness of our own understanding. To admire and support disciplines and intellectual interests different from our own.
To resist laziness, indifference, and contempt. To deny the temptation to waste time. To resist distorting the gifts of pleasure, entertainment, and technology so that they thwart our efforts to learn.
To value and respect one another as members of the UPike family. Help us in all of this.
We can become a community that loves our neighbor and pursues truth. We are expected to help one another in this. Shored up by our hope and grace, will you help one another?
We will.
Will you encourage and direct us with patience and compassion as we learn what it means to pursue truth and love one another?
We will. And will you do the same for us and for each other?
We will.
Today we commit ourselves to the pursuit of truth, heart, soul, mind, and strength. We also commit to act in ways that love one another and to thereby maintain a transformative learning community at the University of Pikeville.
O Lord, hear our prayer. Thank you.
Thank you, Jared, for your words. Yola, it's a privilege to share the stage with you today. May now I leave you with a blessing, and of course, in convocation style, you're up and down. So I'm going to ask the students to stand and to receive this blessing. I know. But as soon as we're done, you're off to class. You can groan more. Receive now this blessing. May the faithful one who raised Jesus from the dead raise up within you the passion and action to work for life and areas of depression, anxiety, and despair. May the Spirit, which stirs up order in your life, creativity in your dreaming, and new energy for the demanding people in your world, now quicken your minds for learning, being challenged with surprising truths, those stretching labs, and all those delicate time schedules. May the Lord Jesus provide you new friends, deeper family relationships, a vision to see the greatness within you, and tangible encounters of God's love, affirming that you are not alone on this journey. Now go into this academic year, refusing to be drugged down by hate, defeated by the very real obstacles of bills, stress, and uncertainty. And may you be overwhelmed and empowered by God's peace to give grace when it's not deserved, work crazy hard when it seems impossible, and to continue to lean in when fear shouts stop. You are the child of God. Now as you leave this gathering, know that we are better because you are here. Amen.